ministry to the pro-life cause. He fought the legislation of abortion in New York before the 1973 Roe versus Wade Supreme Court decision and helped to organize the first National March for Life in Washington in 1974. He served as a witness to uphold the Hyde Amendment banning federal funding of abortion in most circumstances. In 1989, Msgr. Reilly founded the Helpers of God's Precious Infants Incorporated to focus on prayer efforts and sidewalk counseling outside of abortion clinics. For over 20 years, 5 days a week, he has counseled and prayed on the streets outside of abortion clinics. He continues to serve as the executive director of the Helpers of God's Precious Infants and travels internationally to train others how to hold peaceful, loving prayer vigils and to offer constructive assistance to those in crises before and after abortion. So at this time, please give a warm round of applause and a St. Gerard's welcome to Msgr. Phillip J. Reilly.
An honor to be here with you this evening. Dr. Frankowski and I are old friends.
Really close. That's better.
I gave her a phone call when she was a student in Washington, D.C. And I asked her if she would help to organize the first prayer vigil in Washington, D.C. And she said she had many things to do. She was very busy with her studies. Well, she did help to organize the first prayer vigil for life in Washington, D.C. And now she practically spends her life for life, which is beautiful. And I commend you and I congratulate you on the marvelous work that St. Gerard Center is doing for life and the people who support you spiritually and financially. And for the mothers who have chosen life, my deepest admiration, because it requires great courage. You know, it's difficult to raise a child with mom and dad on your own with an income, but to suddenly raise the child by yourself and not really knowing where your next meal is coming from. And they go from a moment of weakness to practicing heroic virtue, and they are to be admired. Okay? And sometimes people say, oh, keep the child. It's not that easy. And people like yourselves and St. Gerard Center, you make credible for us when we're out on the sidewalks counseling the women to keep the child. Because if you didn't have a place like St. Gerard's, our offer of help would become shallow. And so I thank you myself, the example you do here. And, you know, I just came back from Mexico. They have a group there called VIVAC. I don't know if you're acquainted with VIVAC. They started 25 years ago. And they have centers for helping the mothers right across the country now. And it's a very elaborate programs that they have. But again, in spite of that, they are trying to force abortion down the people in Mexico. You know, there was a fellow in prison in the Middle Ages, and he had a life imprisonment as his term. And one day he says to the other fellow that was in the cell with him, he said, "I'm getting out of here." The guy said, "You're getting out of here." He said, "Yeah." He called the guard over, and he said to the guard, he said, tell the king that if he lets me out of here for 1 year, at the end of 1 year, he said, I'll teach his horse to fly. And he said, tell the king If I don't teach the horse to fly in 1 year, he can kill me. Go tell him, go tell him. So the guard left. And the other fellow in the cell said to him, Are you crazy? You're going to lose your life. And he said, well, I'm not going to spend the rest of my life here in this prison cell. He said, maybe, you know, I'll spend the year in freedom. I'll spend the year in freedom. It's worth it. He said, you know, you never know. He said, at the end of 1 year, he said, maybe I'll die. My last year will be a year of freedom. He said, on the other hand, he said, maybe at the end of the year, the king will die. And I go free. You see? And he said, well, maybe the horse will fly. And it's that attitude that we need. The horse will fly. Okay? And you say, impossible. Well, you know, who would have thought 25, 30 years ago that the source of life and the example for life would come from Eastern Europe as opposed to the West? Right? You know, recently in Hungary, they changed their constitution. It went into effect on January 1st of this year. And in Hungary, they changed the constitution that now, and it was voted through, it's in effect, that's in accordance to the constitution of Hungary, human life will be protected from the moment of conception until natural death. Thank you. In the Hungarian constitution, it says, only a marriage between a man and a woman will be accepted in Hungary, no other types. Who would have thought the horse will fly? Yeah. I remember the first time I went to Hungary, I went to this young girl called me on the phone, and I didn't know that much Hungarian, she didn't know that much English, but she asked who I was, and I said, I'm Msgr. Reilly. And in Europe, the word Monsignor is the terminology used for a bishop. So she said, oh, Bishop Reilly. I said, well, no, I'm not a bishop. I'm not a bishop. And I couldn't quite get across to her. So I said to her, you know, in a mood of lightness, I said to her, you know the difference between a bishop, a priest, and a Monsignor? And she said, no. I said, well, I'll tell you the difference. I said, a priest is ordained, and a bishop is consecrated, and a Monsignor is a title created by the church. And everybody knows the definition of creation is to make something out of nothing. She didn't quite understand. So I was still trying to get across to her, you see, that I wasn't a bishop, I was just a lowly Monsignor, you see. But she ended up putting down not that I was a vice bishop, but when I finally got to this St. Stephen's Cathedral in Budapest, Hungary, in the evening, the whole cathedral was lit up. And it was lit up, I said, oh no, this can't be a pro-life mass. It looks like the cathedral is full. And I went into the sacristy, and all those priests were in the sacristy. I said, my God, this is not a pro-life mass. What is this? And then I said, wait a second. What did she put down? What did she put down? They think I'm a bishop. What she put down was that instead of a vice bishop or something, she put down, I was a bishop of vice. And all the priests wanted to come and see the bishop of vice. As a matter of fact, the whole church was filled to see the bishop of vice. And I said, oh my God, they do think I'm a bishop. So I went to go out from the sacristy into the church, and all the Hungarian priests turned around to me, and they went. So I went back to them. I thought it was a Hungarian greeting, you know? So they repeated the Hungarian greeting. So I said, I guess you do it twice. So I put the Hungarian thing. And, oh my God, I said, oh, wait a second. They want the bishop's hat. They want the bishop's hat. They're not letting me out of the sacristy until I put the hat on, the mitre. I don't have a mitre. The only thing, I went back, and the only thing I had there I brought with me was an old New York Met baseball cap. So I went back and I said, I'm not getting out of this sacristy until the mitre on, see? So I very formally picked up the hat, you know, very formally. I put it on my head properly to say, let's go, you see? And I said, they're looking at me, I said, in America, very liberal, very liberal. So we go out into the sanctuary. As I'm going out into the sanctuary, when you know, I look to my left, and not only were the priest and the people there to see the Bishop of Vice, but the cardinal was sitting in the sanctuary. I got that hat off so fast. But you know, it was 15 years ago. And 15 years ago, what we started was in the eastern part of Europe, the abortions are done for the most part in the hospitals rather than in freestanding clinics. And it's socialized medicine. So the poor doctors, you know, they don't receive very much money. But they come in, we'll say, on Monday, and they deliver the babies on the second floor. And on Tuesday, they come in, and they have to kill the children on the third floor. They are not adamant for abortion. And one doctor was saying to me, Father, I cannot sleep the night before. My hands are shaking. My hands are shaking. So what we did, we started the prayer vigils outside the hospitals in Hungary. And eventually, we found to our surprise, the administrators of the hospital, the people themselves, would come out and join us. Come out and join us. I mean, we did a prayer vigil up in Riga, Latvia, and the people there were afraid to go out to the streets because under 70 years of communism, if you went and publicly assembled, you went to jail. And so they couldn't really believe that they were free. But for the sake of the children, the first time they went out, okay, and they did the prayer vigil. And when they came back, not only were they happy to do something for the child, but they felt, my God, we are free. We are free. Okay? And so what happened is and the cardinal I met there, he was a real cardinal. He was a real cardinal. He was, you know? Anyways, I remember when I was arrested. More than once, okay? After I was arrested, some of my fellow priests said to me, Phil, you'll never be a bishop now. I said, what do you mean? Well, you were arrested. You were arrested. I said, I thought I was one up on you. I said, when did they change the rules? He said, they changed. I said, look, what are you talking about? I said, I thought a condition of being a bishop was to be arrested. I thought that was a requirement. They said, what do you mean? I said, weren't all the apostles arrested for witnessing the truth? I said, wasn't my leader Jesus? He was arrested. They killed him because of witnessing the truth. I thought that was a requirement of being a bishop. I said, I thought that's why they give you a scarlet cassock, because to shed your blood for the truth. Well, when I was in Riga, Latvia, this cardinal came in the scarlet cassock, but he was coming from prison. That was his first time back into his see. And I felt really honored to be talking to this cardinal who had suffered for years in prison, you see, in Latvia. You know, there was a priest, a Jesuit priest called Father Chizek, Polish. And Father Chizek went to Russia to bring God to Russia. Remember you read the book with God in Russia by Father Chizek, or He Leadeth Me? And when he was in prison, it was interesting, they would just give him some gruel in the morning, about 4:30 in the morning, and that would be it for the day. And they went into prison actually before Vatican II, so they didn't know about any of the changes. And when they would smuggle into the camp some bread and wine, the word would go forth, and they would pass up that gruel. You remember the old Eucharistic fast for the older people here, okay? The old Eucharistic fast was you could not take a drop of water from midnight the night before until you had received the Eucharist. There was no such thing as an hour, 3 hours, no. It was not a drop of water. And in the prison, that's the fast they kept. And so when they smuggled into the camps the bread and the wine, and the word went forth, everybody passed up the gruel, which was that for the next 48 hours. That's all they would get. And then at lunchtime, there was no lunch, but there was a break. And what they would do is they would put the bread and wine on a trunk of a cut trunk of a tree, and Father Chizek, from memory, would recite the Eucharistic prayer at the risk of his life. And then the people would come one by one to receive the Eucharist at the risk of their lives. And he said to me, Father, it was one of the finest masses I ever offered, was in the prison camps. It was the real passion of Christ that I understood I was offering, the sacrifice. Well, it happened that he didn't die. They cannot still figure out how he possibly could have lived with 25, 35 years in prison. But he got free because he outlived them. And he was starting to offer Mass in Russia, doing what he intended to do. And he told me he started the Easter Vigil Mass, like 9 at night, and the word went forth, there's a priest offering Mass. And all through the night, people came from long distances. So at 9 o'clock the next morning, he was still giving out the Eucharist in Russia, atheist Russia. And you have to understand, in Russia, atheism was imposed upon the people. It's not something they accepted. All the churches were closed down, turned into department stores. The people themselves resisted. The people themselves went to prison. They died for their faith, and they could not wait until the doors would be open again. I remember doing a prayer vigil in a city called Bratislava, Slovakia. And we were going through the main area. And as we were going through the main area, it was a Saturday evening, a Sunday evening, and we were going this prayer vigil up the mountainside there. And I noticed all these young people kneeling in the village square on their knees. And I later said to the people, I said, what were all those young people doing? And she said, oh, Father, there's no room for them in the church. No room for them in the church, Bratislava, Slovakia. And so what happened was, Father Chizek was suddenly, they had told the Jesuits, they told the Vatican he was dead. And suddenly two prisoners were caught in an area called, in New Jersey, Englewood, New Jersey, two Russian prisons, and they suddenly said, we'll do a swap. What a swap. We'll give you Father Chizek. We'll give you Father Chizek for the two prisons. And so what was involved was the State Department, ours, Russian State Department, the Vatican, and Father Chizek knew nothing about this, and the swap was made. And suddenly, Father Chizek, who was so happy, finally he was bringing God to Russia, was picked up by the KGB, put on a plane, and was back here in the United States, not even know what was going on. And when he came back here, he said, he looked and he said, my God, the doors of your churches were never closed. How blessed you are. Your churches are open. And then he said, I started to go into the churches, one church after another. And he said, they're empty. Where are all the young people? Where are the people? Who did this to you? Who did this to you? What enemy did this to you? Our churches were closed. We resisted. We went to prison. We died. We could not wait to have them open. And now they're starting to flourish. Here, your churches were not closed. They are emptied. Who did this to you? You see, we have become practical atheists in this country. The country itself, God has been excluded. Piece by piece, commandment by commandment, has been taken apart. And no resistance. They're using the word choice, freedom, and all the other words that are used, and we accepted what people in the Iron Curtain countries died to defend, and we did not. And suddenly what we have a country in which the Ten Commandments of God have been removed, and we haven't even noticed it. The first three commandments, we've excluded God from the public square. Oh, you know they had in Russia what they call a freedom of worship. Notice the administration uses those words, freedom of worship. Freedom of worship means you can go to a church if you can find one that you can get into, and you can worship there, but you must not bring anything of your religion and of God outside that church. That's not the First Amendment. The First Amendment is freedom of religion and conscience, where you can bring God to the streets. So they tell us, no, you have freedom of worship. That's being used here. Watch out for it. That was under the communist. Right? And eventually what happened is the freedom of worship has resulted in that we are told you cannot start the day in school with prayer, the reading of the Bible. You cannot bring God into the public square. You cannot bring God anywhere. God is excluded. And so we've passed, the blue laws were removed. Oh, it's not going to affect anything. What do you mean affect anything? On the Lord's Day now, it's the shopping malls. On the Lord's Day now, it's the ball games. On the Lord's Day, it's not the Lord's Day at all. People don't even think about the Lord. We're practical atheists. And we worship hedonism and materialism and everything else and don't even know it. And the first three commandments of God are shot. Shot. And the fifth commandment, thou shalt not kill. You know, everybody thinks of the culture of death. It started with Roe v. Wade. Roe v. Wade. No, it didn't. It ended with Roe v. Wade. Roe v. Wade was the culmination of the culture of death. It was not the big end of the culture of life. That's not where the culture of death began with Roe v. Wade. That was the culmination of the culture of death. It was the end of the culture of life. Why? Because what did Roe v. Wade do? Roe v. Wade didn't just remove the right to life from the unborn children. My God, no. There was a whole philosophical battle that took place before that decision. Our founding fathers believed that life was a gift of God. It was sacred. And no one had a right to take your life, an innocent life, no matter what the condition was, because life was from God, and only God gives life and God takes life, period. And we believe that. And suddenly what they did was, in that decision, the battle was that a person's life, the sanctity of your life was absolute before that decision. The quality of your life was relative. No matter what the quality of your life, no one had the right to take your life. Suddenly, in Roe v. Wade, we turned that upside down. And we said, what is the absolute is the quality of life, and your right to life depends on the quality of your life as determined by others, not by you. Right? In other words, we divided the time of pregnancy into three trimesters. What are you talking about, three trimesters? And each of the first 3 months, as you change and the quality of your life becomes more meaningful, we start now to grant you a gift of life. But you don't get your life until you're born. Now, what in the God's name does citizenship have to do with being a human being and a person? Nothing. Nothing. There's no difference between a child who is born and 1 minute before it isn't born. Citizenship has nothing to do with humanity and personhood and whether you have a right to life or not. We start to buy this. Well, you can kill the unborn child because it's not yet been born. It's not yet a citizen. What in the name of God are you talking about? That's why we need an amendment to the Constitution that says you are a human being and a person from the moment of your conception unto natural death, period. And so what happened was this, that decision was not the end of protection of the unborn children, it was the end of Western civilization. Because Western civilization believed that the quality of a person's life was relative, okay? The sanctity of your life was absolute, and no matter what the condition of your life, you had a right to life. And suddenly we turned that upside down, and that we made that a person's right to life depended on the quality as determined by others. So in that term of gestation, it kept changing the conditions under which you could kill the child. Until finally when the child is born, you can still kill it if it's a Down syndrome child. You can still do all different things to it. Or if you go to the other end of the spectrum, when grandma's quality of life has gone down, you can kill her. It's called euthanasia. And so suddenly, the fifth commandment to God has been changed. The fifth commandment was, thou shalt not kill an innocent human being. And now the fifth commandment to God in this country that we accept is thou shalt not kill an innocent human being unless the quality of their life is not acceptable to you. Then you can kill them. Whether it be grandma or the unborn child, the Down syndrome child, you do know you don't see very many Down syndrome children running around anymore, do you? It's because 90 out of every 100 now in the United States are killed. In Europe, 95 out of every 100 are killed, okay? Because the quality of life is not acceptable. And so what has happened is, slowly but surely, the sixth and ninth commandment, of course, it's gone. It's gone. You see, the purpose, it's rather simple. God intends human life to come into existence as a result of an act of human love. And God intends human sexual love never to deliberately exclude human life. They go together. And once you have separated those, and you do it with contraceptives, you open the door to homosexuality. There's no way you can argue against homosexuality today. What's the matter with it? A contraceptive act is sterile, and so is theirs. And once you allow that you can have life without human love and sexuality, then you open the door to in vitro fertilization. It's all interconnected, you see. It's all interconnected. And what we have to do is, we have become, without realizing it, without even resisting it, we have become atheist in our practice, in our lives. What Russia could not do, they did by choice in this country, without any resistance. And so it is that I say to you, in the Eastern Bloc countries today, they are going to come as our saviors. They are going to come to save the world. In Poland, the parliament just passed an overwhelming vote. There'll be no more abortions in Poland. In Russia, you cannot have an abortion after 12 weeks in Russia. And now, the president of Russia just signed a bill saying you cannot advertise abortion in Russia unless you put down in that advertisement, abortion is a dangerous medical procedure for mother. Amazing. When I was going just recently to a national conference for life in Australia, I got a phone call from where for a national conference for life? From Russia. So there is reason for hope, right? There's reason for hope. And so what we have to do is to know that, you know, it's amazing that the horse will fly. Where will it fly? It's flying in the Eastern Bloc countries. They are a source of strength. They are the source of hope for us. We have to bring God to the streets. And that's what people are doing across this country and around the world. It doesn't make any difference. You say you can't pray. You can't pray in the public buildings. You can't pray in the schools. Fine. We'll pray in the streets. And we'll bring God to the people in the streets. And that's what is happening. That is what is happening. Our Holy Father, John Paul II, the late John Paul II, he asked in section 100 in the Evangelium Vitae that there be an international movement of prayer from every street, from every city, from every town across the world that will rise up from the streets to the throne of God. They'll change hearts and bring a culture of life back to the world. You know, when John Paul II spoke to the young people in Denver at the World Youth Day, you know what he said to them? He said, young people, I say to you, be not afraid. Be not afraid to go out into the public square. Be not afraid to go out and pray in the streets. Be not afraid to go where today's modern day Calvary is, where the innocent blood is being shed. These are the people that need you. Be not afraid to bring Christ at any time. Shout it from the rooftops. Don't listen to these dumb decisions. And so it is, I see helpers, ordinary people, across this country, around the world. Ordinary people doing ordinary things with extraordinary results. And I say to the people, remember why you go. When you go to pray, yes, we want to save babies. But they're not the ones most affected by this culture of death. The ones most affected by the culture of death. You see, the child, it never did an evil in its life, even if it dies through an abortion. There's no impediment there, no obstacle there for the child to receive the fullness of life and to go to God. No question. But the people doing this, they need our presence. They're in darkness. The people doing this are without hope. They need the hope of Christ. And when we go, you go primarily to save souls. You go for the people who are most affected by the culture of death. It's not the children. It's the parents. It's the politicians. It's priests and bishops if we're weak and not speaking out. You know how they think they have a silent no more? I want to take the silent no more and put it in front of every pulpit. That's what you want. If we as priests would speak and proclaim from the pulpits across this country and around this world, we could change the world within a decade. And so what we ask you to do is this. Continue to give that public witness. Public witness. You say, what am I accomplishing? It's not you, it's God through you. It's God through you. Everyone touches someone. Everyone brings, you know, I say to the young people, I say, look, you know, you might think that your light of praying outside of a clinic is not that bright. But think of it this way. You are a candle at midnight in midday. You know, if you had a little match and no one would notice you with the match. But suppose this place, it was all dark and there was only one exit out and you had a little match. It was total darkness. Everybody would see that and they'd come to the door to get out. Okay? So your little light, because of the darkness we live in, it shines bright. And you start to put a lot of little lights together, it starts a whole bonfire. And what has happened is this. Every poll now shows in America that overwhelmingly the Americans are for life. Overwhelmingly, young people are for life, right? How did this happen? The media hasn't changed. Academia hasn't changed. The politicians haven't changed. How has this happened? Who did this? It's God's people, the little people. It's people going to the streets and bringing the light of Christ, bringing the love of God, and going there as you do in the right way. Not to condemn, not to make judgments, but you go there with loving, you go there as ambassadors of Jesus Christ. I say to you, now, we're at the point here, we're waiting for the coming of the Holy Spirit. But the mystery of Christianity is this. We're not doing something like Jesus did years ago. Jesus continues to do his work now through his body, the church. And we have risen with Christ, we have ascended with Christ, and the Holy Spirit works through us, and we continue the work of Christ. And the work of Christ is, a world in darkness broken needs a Savior. A world in darkness and broken needs the light, the forgiveness of God. Who's going to bring that to them? Only Jesus can. But Jesus does it through you, through me. So when we go to the abortion clinics, you don't go there with judgmental attitudes. You don't go there in condemnatory. You don't go there to protest or picket. You go there to make present the unconditional, everlasting love of Jesus Christ to those caught in this culture of darkness. And who are they? Not the unborn children. Those innocent souls will go directly to God. The ones who are doing this, it's a moral evil. They need Jesus Christ. They need hope. They need truth. And who's going to bring it to them? You. God uses you, each one of you. I see it all over the world. Little people changing the world so that now they can't figure out how come the majority of the people in America are now pro-life. When we still stop them from praying in the buildings. We still stop them praying in the churches. Still probably everywhere. Because they can't stop us out in the streets. And God's people are there bringing Christ and his truth and his victory to those caught in this culture of death. And conversions keep taking place all across this country, all around the world. There is reason for hope because the horse will fly because Jesus has risen and his work continues through you. Do keep it up. God bless you.